IVM. Hello and welcome to the Ganatantra podcast. I am Sariu Natarajan.
And I'm Alok Prasanna Kumar.
So we are breaking our weekly cycle to record a very special episode to discuss the Citizenship Amendment Act in the backdrop of protests across the nation, the imposition of Section 144 of the Criminal Procedure Code in parts of Karnataka and in all of Uttar Pradesh, and internet shutdowns across the country to prevent slash monitor slash regulate the protests. So we thought we'd take a break and provide some context to our listeners about these landmark protests and the responses that have come from various parts of the country to this to the Citizenship Amendment Act.
Yeah. So just to give you a little, just to give everyone a little bit of background, the Citizenship Amendment Act, which was passed last week, actually has its origins a little earlier. There was an earlier draft which first came out in 2016, and it can actually be traced to a promise made in the BJP manifesto, which said that we will give Hindus in Pakistan and Hindus in Bangladesh and Afghanistan citizenship in India. Now, the basic framework for this was set by certain notifications issued in 2015, which allowed illegal migrants from these communities to stay in India beyond their visa period, or were given long-term visas on the ground that these minorities are being persecuted on the basis of their religion. It wasn't just Hindus from these countries, but also Hindus, Sikhs, Parsis, Christians, and so on, pointedly excluding Muslims. Now, this has formed the basis of an amendment to the Citizenship Act, which says that people who are living in India, although they entered India illegally but are being permitted to do so, can now apply for citizenship. This is a huge change because illegal migrants cannot apply for citizenship. Like, you can't apply to be naturalized, you can't apply to get citizenship as a, you know, through certification, which you can otherwise do if you're a legal migrant who's been resident for a certain number of years in India. But once again, the Amendment Act pointedly excludes Muslims. So if you meet four criteria as an illegal immigrant, you will be allowed to apply for citizenship. What are the four criteria? You have to be Hindu, Sikh, Christian, Parsi, so on and so forth. You have to be from one of these three countries, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and Bangladesh. It goes without saying they're Muslim majority countries. You have to have come to India before 31st December 2014. All right. So anybody who came in afterwards, or anybody who comes in after this law comes into the picture, won't be covered. Fourth criteria is that you should have gotten an exemption from the Passport Act and the Foreigners Act, right? Which means that you won't be kicked out of the country. You have been allowed to stay here, even though you didn't come here with a valid visa and so on. Now, keep in mind that these are not the only groups of people in India who have come because of religious persecution. We've had Rohingyas who've come to India. We've had Sri Lankan Tamils. We have seen
Ahmadiyyas
from Pakistan. Potentially Shias from Pakistan. And I mean, you can imagine any number of groups who might have come to India as a result of religious persecution in their countries, even perhaps maybe atheists in Bangladesh.
Perhaps.
We don't know. But what this act does is that we will allow only people belonging to these communities from these countries who've come into India in these circumstances to apply for citizenship, which is a huge difference because citizenship under the Indian Constitution has no link to religion, race, ethnicity, and so on. This is something that, you know, is like one of those founding ideals of the Republic. You're talking about a huge, I mean, it was revolutionary for its time. We've sort of, I think, briefly discussed this in Ornit Shani's episode, which we recorded a few weeks ago, when in guaranteeing universal suffrage, India ensured citizenship was available to everyone, irrespective of religion, race, caste, ethnicity, language, and so on, which countries have used in the past to cut people off access to citizenship. India was one of the one of those countries in the world which said one fifth of humanity will be allowed to choose, will be given citizenship without having to prove anything about themselves. What this bill and now the Amendment Act has done is said that the government will now apply religion as a criteria for determining citizenship, which is fundamentally, and in my view, and I've written about this in multiple fora, and I keep saying this again and again, is fundamentally unconstitutional.
Yes, it's fundamentally unconstitutional on the face of it.
On the face of it.
Impossible to read it any other way.
Impossible to read it.
The jurisprudence around Article 14 is pretty clear in this regard in terms of saying there has to be an intelligible differentia and a rational nexus to the idea of the legislation, and this does not meet the empirical test that has been laid down in the Supreme Court jurisprudence on this topic.
So, even if we accept the government's argument at its best that no, we are not discriminating on religion, we are only providing those who have fled religious persecution an option to seek citizenship in India, it still leaves open the accusation that clearly some illegal migrants or even those persecuted among religious persecution are more equal than others. And this is the most basic kind of discrimination our constitution was intended to fight against. That is what Article 14 pretty much tells the government, that people who are otherwise similarly placed cannot be treated differently.
Right.
So, in a sense, this goes very fundamentally against the tenets of the Indian constitution. Keeping that in mind, right? What is the implication of this? Now, there is some confusion over what this actually means. To me, the one straightforward conclusion is this is an attempt to introduce a religious sentiment element into the constitution, into the notion of citizenship under the constitution. Today, if you can do it for illegal migrants, tomorrow you might amend the Citizenship Act to say only non-Muslims born from the year of 2021 will be entitled to birthright citizenship.
Yeah.
All right, and that could be extended backwards, could be extended further backwards. So even though today the Citizenship Amendment Act does not affect anyone's citizenship as it stands, tomorrow, once the principle is accepted that religion can be used to determine someone's citizenship under the constitution, it can be extended anywhere and in whatever direction, and we will not be able to stop it.
Absolutely. And the idea is that what it does is it violates against the basic principle of equality and the idea of equal citizenship and secularism that is enshrined in the constitution. Yet, this is a slippery slope. So today it is one minority ethnic group. Tomorrow it could be another. Because what accepting this Citizenship Amendment Act also does is that you're also accepting the principle that citizenship can be cordoned off and defined in particular ways. And in this case, a partisan way.
Yeah.
So othering, which is a conscious process that happens politically, can very well be extended to somebody else.
Exactly.
Now, that's not an argument, or the other utilitarian argument that's often made is that this is a very small segment of the population.
Yeah.
You know, why should you bother about it?
Yeah.
But the acceptance of the principle is sort of lays the ground for entry into a very problematic imagination of nationhood.
Yeah. And I think in that sense, Maybe the government perhaps saw only the utilitarian part of this argument and did not think anyone would come out and protest on the principle of it. And and of course, there are people who are worried about how this will be linked to NRC, which we will take 2 minutes to talk about later. But I do get the sense that people get the principle at the core of this. The principle at the core of this is to say no to Muslims, that you can never be considered proper citizens of this country. And if you are citizens, it's because on sufferance. That is not a constitutional right.
And also the monolithic idea of Islam, right? That if you bear a certain, or if you bear a Muslim name or a Muslim identity, even in part, that you cannot be prosecuted in a Muslim majority country.
Yeah.
And that's a very problematic imagination, because the idea of monolithic Islam, and I think we've brought this up in a couple of episodes before, is very problematic and hurts the Muslims, and particularly the disadvantaged Pasmanda Muslims, the most in this context.
Yes.
So to think about an idea of a monolithic Islam in the political process, othered, there's a significant way in which that affects how the idea of India is imagined.
Imagine, exactly. And of course, we hope to go into Pasmanda politics and the discourse soon. We'll discuss this in more detail. But specifically to come back to what I mentioned, there's a lot of confusion over what NRC means, what it will do. To give people a little bit of context, the NRC process, which took place in Assam, had a specific statutory backing to it. That is Section 6A of the Citizenship Act. This was introduced following the Assam Accords to basically identify people who had come into India post-71 and sort of question their citizenship status as a result of that. Now, it wasn't implemented for the bulk of three decades, the 80s, 2000s, and it was only the Supreme Court which pushed implementation in 2014. And we have now seen that 1.9 million people have been left off the list. Now, keep in mind, this 1.9 million, though no official figures have been said, it is not as if it is by and large only Muslims. There is a large section of Hindus and Muslims who have been left out. There are large numbers of tribals left out. There are especially large number of women have been left out.
And we had this fantastic episode with Dr. Smitana Saikia,
yes,
which was really, I want to say, a couple of months ago, in the early part of season 2, which talks about this process and who's been excluded,
yes,
and why it's particularly been problematic in the way it's been operationalized in Assam.
Yes. Now, we have heard this constant refrain from Amit Shah that NRC will be extended to the whole country, NRC will be extended to the whole country. We don't know what that will look like because there is currently no legislative framework like Section 6A, which says what an NRC for the rest of India will look like. A lot of people have confused the National Population Register for an NRC. At best, it could form a document which will create a list of residents, of then, you know, then going on to prepare a list of citizens. But it doesn't tell us, one, what is the cutoff date, right? Because an NRC is basically to ensure that there's a cutoff date to show that you have been in India since a certain point of time. Two, we haven't been told what will be the basis for citizenship. Now, the basis for citizenship is still Section 3 of the Citizenship Act, which says that, you know, if you were born in India prior to 86, you are considered a valid citizen. If you were born between 86 and 2003, to at least one parent who was a citizen, you're a citizen. And post-2003, to at least one parent who was a citizen, and provided the other parent was an illegal migrant, you'll be a citizen. Now, if this has to be established by the citizen, there is no way in which most people will be able to do this if the same procedure followed in Assam was followed. Because most of the documents that people tend to think are proof of citizenship are not proof of citizenship. You know, the Aadhaar card is not proof of citizenship. Your passport is not proof of citizenship. Your driving license, your electoral ID card, these are not proof of citizenship. These are consequences of your citizenship. I just happened to see, before we recorded this episode, a clarification issued by the government, which seems to suggest that they have sort of finally understood that they can't try and replicate the Assam NRC process in the rest of India. And they seem to have said, again, this is not like an official document, but it is something put out on Twitter by the government of India, which sort of said, no, we will try and allow you to prove your citizenship through any number of means. Now, and to ensure that no genuine citizen of India loses out. Again, this is not a legal statement. In law, you will have to show how, you'll have to prove the veracity of these documents. Because if anybody could prove documents, I'm 100% sure that we'll end up giving citizenship to about 110% of India's population.
Well, also with these documents, there's, I mean, very many of them, we know some of the processes on ground as to how these documents are created and negotiated.
Exactly.
And, you know, in the early days of my fieldwork, I must tell this, I was walking along in the site, a man comes up to me and he's like, "Madam, you want any document? You want Aadhaar card? You want license? Any document I can make for you."
Yeah.
And I think the implication of that, if I may say so myself, was that I can print these for you and not necessarily legitimately mediate for you with the state.
Yes.
And so there is, to your point, that a large number of people are likely to be brought in, even outside of actual citizens in that sense, is possible.
And here's the thing, right? Because again, the definition of citizenship, for those of us born prior to 87, Saru and me count ourselves among the lucky ones. We just have to show
older millennials.
We can just show our date of birth, and that's enough. But for people born after that, which is, I think, a large bulk of the population, given how much of India is below the age of 35, you'll have to not only show your documents, but your parents' documents.
Yeah.
Right? And again, these are all assurances being given by government, but in the absence of a legal framework which actually says, right, what an NRC process will look like, if anything like the Assam process is replicated, you're going to have total disaster.
Absolutely. And I think that that's sort of one of the big reasons to find the Citizenship Amendment Act and the related but not directly consequential NRC problematic.
Yeah.
But I also think there are other contextual factors that one must keep in mind in understanding and parsing this problem.
Yeah.
One is the Supreme Court itself and the way in which the Supreme Court, the recent jurisprudence of the Supreme Court has evolved.
Yeah.
We had a fantastic episode with Dr. Aparna Chandra,
yes,
who's at the National Law University of Delhi presently, who talks about how some of the way in which the Supreme Court is constituted, the way in which decision-making has happened, the way in which cases are brought up to the Supreme Court is in itself problematic, and the consequences of it in the decision-making. And to keep that in mind in thinking that the Supreme Court is the site where the constitutionality of the CAA will be negotiated.
Yeah.
So that's one thing to keep in mind. The second, of course, is the broader, what one can sense, I suppose, the animal spirits around the politics in which the way politics and sort of political responses to the current protests have evolved.
Yeah.
There have been comments which delegitimize protesters by calling them urban naxals, by saying things like you can recognize them by their clothes. While the NRC and the CAA are not directly linked to each other and there's potential enormous avenues for this to go either which way.
Yeah.
The intention very much is for them to be imagined as being together.
Exactly. And I think it goes back to something which we ended our episode with, or that Shani with, is does the government see the NRC as an exclusionary process or an inclusionary process? Because if you recall, preparing the electoral rolls was about trying to include as many people as possible. But the NRC in Assam was seen as trying to exclude as many people as possible. And if the vision of the government in creating an NRC is to exclude as many people as possible, it doesn't matter how many documents they prescribe or what procedures they follow, you will end with large-scale exclusions.
True, and a lot of what has happened with the NRC in Assam and is likely to happen in the context of any such NRC being extended to the rest of the country,
yeah,
is that it's going to be like left to administrative discretion in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
Even, for example, the idea of who is a refugee is an administrative question, right?
That's
it's
right.
Determined at the administrative level. So I think this is inherently political and also problematic in the way our constitution is structured.
Yeah.
But also, I think for our listeners, remember that this, the site of this litigation or this debate or this negotiation is going to be the Supreme Court, which has its own politics in the way it's constituted and therefore acts. So be careful, listen to Dr. Aparna Chandra's episode.
Yeah.
What we also want to do before we wrap up this very brief episode is talk about Section 144, which is Section 144 of the Criminal Procedure Code, and try and understand how that is being used as a mechanism to regulate or police protests.
Yeah.
Section 144 was imposed over the last 24 hours. We're recording on the 19th of December. Was imposed in the last 24 hours in Bangalore and in parts of Uttar Pradesh, and also I think other parts of Karnataka as well.
Yes.
And has been in force on and off in other parts of the country as well. But so Section 144 is a problematic colonial era
which basically says that you can't have, the government can use its powers to prevent gatherings of more than 5 persons or more if it fears any threat to law and order. Courts have tried over the few years. There was a Supreme Court judgment authored by Justice Sikri, which sort of highlighted how 144 can't be used to quash peaceful assembly. But the fact is, most of these things are so temporary, it's not possible to rush to the courts to get it quashed. I know people tried in the morning in Karnataka High Court, but the High Court said, yeah, we'll hear it tomorrow. So the thing is that this is a provision which actually goes back all the way to one of the initial criminal procedures, and it's to control mobs. It was to try and control the population, and it comes from a point of view which believes that the purpose of the police is to control the people to protect the government. And constitution or no constitution, it sort of is largely misused for this purpose. But let's also keep in mind that it has been quite largely flouted by people.
In fact, even today,
if
anybody sees any visuals from town hall in Bangalore
even Chennai,
or from Lucknow
or
in Uttar Pradesh,
yeah.
I think Chennai, they finally got permission, but
okay.
I think Lucknow in Uttar Pradesh and other parts of Uttar Pradesh, including parts where there are a blackout, we can see that people have flouted 144 with impunity.
Yeah, it is. And in the sense that even if the government intended to use this purely for a law or a measure, it is being perceived as one to, quash dissent in some way. And once people lose the fear of the law and lose the fear of the police, in some ways the government has a lot to worry about. That it can no longer maintain any facade of doing this in the name of law and order, and it's seen as one becoming government versus citizens. So there is of course a lot more to happen. There we see there are more protests scheduled in the coming days. It's now, I suppose, finally. So I think in a sense some of the protests were largely spontaneous, because these were organized by very small groups of people who got people, the number of people who turned up surprised them also, perhaps to some extent. Maybe we might see more organized mobilizing by political parties and larger organizations. And we might see more of this in the days coming ahead. But just to keep in mind that in terms of how people are responding to this, this is something that has struck some deep chord in people's minds. That it's not just about whether or not these 31,000 people identified as illegal migrants by the government get citizenship, or whether there are any other people who might get citizenship. It's about something foundational and fundamental about the Constitution of India and the need to sort of protect it from any government interference, which seems to have spawned this.
Absolutely. And the very possibility that this presents an entry for any other form of exclusion. Today it is Muslims, tomorrow it could be somebody else, any other group, particularly disenfranchised groups that the state would want to exclude. It's a very real possibility that this presents that kind of entry.
Yeah.
And I think that's what makes this political, and I think that's the imagination that has resonated with the protesters.
Yeah.
There have been protests all across the country. One other thing to think about in the context of this entire debate is also the question of internet shutdowns,
yes,
which have been, well, in Kashmir. We discussed that four months ago to be precise,
yes.
In our episode with Dr. Andrew Whitehead and in an episode that Alok and I did. But this has been a tool by which the Indian government has tried to censor communication around the protests and also preventing mobilization.
Yeah, I think we've gotten some significant judicial pushback, because literally just before we began recording, I saw that the Guwahati High Court had directed the government to resume internet services today at 5 p.m.
Yes.
So, I mean, the news came out of this after 5 p.m.
Yes.
Which is, we're recording this in the
potentially
evening.
Because there was no internet.
Potentially because there was no internet, fair enough.
Yeah.
But also, we are seeing, I guess, in some senses, a pushback. We need to see whether the government will appeal this or will try to bring it back or ignore the order. But clearly there is now a pushback in Assam which says that we don't see any circumstance for you to shut down the internet. If there are violent people, deal with violent people.
Yeah.
If there are rumors being spread, deal with those rumors being spread. There's no reason or justification to shut down internet en masse, for even court functioning is being affected. Businesses are being affected. That argument is expressly being affected, being accepted and pushed back.
Yeah.
So maybe we might start seeing a greater pushback against this.
Possibly. And I think there was a significant amount of protest in the context of the Delhi-Gurgaon expressway,
yes,
also being shut,
yeah,
and people being stuck for hours on end, and
yeah,
flights being cancelled. And so some of the business productivity questions are also to be considered in negotiating or imagining these things.
Yeah.
But I think that's all we have for you today.
Yeah.
This is a short episode which we hope gives a bit of context in thinking about the CAA, as well as Section 144, as well as internet shutdowns. There's a whole lot of resources available in terms of being able to think about them.
Mm.
On the CAA, there's quite an extensive bit of writing. Shoaib Daniel had a series, is starting or writing a little bit about the links between the CAA and NRC and the politics of it. On Section 144, there's a whole lot of literature. I think Gautam Bhatia has a couple of on his blog, Indian Constitutional Law and Philosophy, which again has a lot of documentation about Section 144 and its effects. And SFLC has documented internet shutdowns in India. In fact, I saw a tweet that said they're getting death threats. So there's that as well. But SFLC has documented internet shutdowns, and there's also starting to be some writing around content governance, around internet shutdowns and internet governance in the context of India.
Yeah.
So there's a whole lot of resources. We've tried to talk about some of them. Some of our past episodes do give a bit of context in terms of these issues. There's Dr. Suan's episode and Dr. Smitana's episode that give a bit of context about the NRC and the protests in the Northeast. Yeah, there's also an episode very recently released with Dr. Ronit Shani where we discuss inclusion and exclusion in the context of the Indian polity.
Yeah.
This is the process of making the first electoral rolls and what that means for India's democracy. But there's a lot of resources, so please go out and look. And we hope this special episode helps you think about this a little bit more.
Yeah. Thank you so much for tuning in to us. We will, of course, resume regular programming as scheduled. We'll be back with our second end-of-the-year special, which was, of course, recorded before all of these events took place in the last few days. So we felt we had to have a special episode to discuss just this. Our second year of end-of-year episode will be dropping on Wednesday. Do stay tuned, and thank you once again for tuning in to our episode. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
I hope you enjoyed that show. We'd like to thank our sponsors this week, Intel, Storytel, and Cambly. And let me tell you a couple of things that you should check out this week. On Storytellers and Storysellers, Vineet is joined by actor Amol Parashar and content strategist at TVF, Akansh Gore. They talk about the risks and rewards they encountered after quitting their traditional jobs for digital media entertainment. On Advertising is Dead, Varun is joined by business head of Gully Gang Entertainment, Chaitanya Kataria. They discuss the rise of new age music. On Litnama, Lakshmi is in conversation with poet Jasmine Khurana. They discuss the trend of slam poetry. On Football Shootball, Gaurav Karthik and Siva talk about Man City's visit to the Emirates Stadium. On Simplified, Chuck and Shriket simplify the impeachment process in the US and discuss the chances of Trump getting impeached. On Geek Fruit, Jishnu is joined by Siddhant Mehta and they do a roundup of the greatest hits and misses of 2019. Thanks and keep listening.
Welcome to Peak Planet, a new podcast where we delve into the fallouts of the growth path that we, and indeed much of the world, has chosen. Sustainable growth is the buzzword. Until we nail that down, we need to ensure that we keep our population healthy and also have the resources for our increasingly urban lifestyles. I'm Karthik Ganesan, a researcher at the Council on Energy, Environment and Water, a Delhi-based policy research institute where for almost a decade we've been trying to explain and change the use, reuse and misuse of our resources. In the first season of Peak Planet, we take up air pollution, public enemy number one, and an invisible one at that. Increasingly, the most important risk factor for adverse health outcomes, air pollution has become the most unwanted byproduct for an aggressively growing economy. Over four episodes, we find out how prepared our systems are to deal with this crisis.
You can catch the entire first season of Peak Planet out now on the IVM Podcasts app or website, or wherever you get your podcasts from.